Conversation with Tehmina Durrani and will be moderated by Ameena, Saiyid. The session will last for 60 minutes, at the end of which there will be a question and answer session. May I ask that you turn off all mobile phones, and may I welcome the speaker to the stage. Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum, ladies and gentlemen. I am delighted to be here today with Tehmina Durrani, who is here with us from Lahore. Thank you very much, Tehmina, for joining us. And I think, ladies and gentlemen, this is a very rare occasion and a very important occasion, because this is the first time in 22 years since the publication of My Feudal Lord in 1991 that Tehmina Durrani has appeared publicly. I'm very proud to say that the Karachi Literature Festival was the first literary event to have invited Tehmina. It's really shocking that her writings, her contribution, have never been recognized in Pakistan. She has been treated as a non-writer, as a non-person, and has never appeared, her work has never been recognized or acknowledged or awarded, and she has never been provided with a chance to interact with her readers and her audience, who are, I think they number in the millions. And for somebody whose book has been translated into 39 languages, and for somebody who's been awarded 7 or 8 honors by Italy, by France, by other countries. She has received the International Women's Award by Italy, the Marisa Belisario Award also by Italy, and many others, but there is silence about her in Pakistan. Tehmina, why is this the case?
Assalamu alaikum, Ameena, and assalamu alaikum to everybody. I'm very pleased to be here. Thank you all for coming and participating. Ameena, your question, I think, is easily answered. My Feudal Lord was such a revolutionary attempt, I think, at that time. We were not ready for it. And I think everybody just felt that this is the story of, you know, an angry book or something, and put it aside, didn't really recognize that there was a lot of other content that went with it. And it took that long for a country like Pakistan to accept a person. It was more about the person than the work and the literature or the other books I wrote. I think the person got branded and put aside.
Yes, Tehmina, what made you begin or think about writing My Feudal Lord? And did it have any consequences, or do you think it had any effect on feudalism and the feudal mindset?
Well, why I wrote My Feudal Lord was because I think that all revolutions are born from injustice. All, if you look at any of them. And injustice, when you are confronted with that kind of injustice, you really are no longer looking at barriers and obstacles and norms and conditioning, and you know, you're ready to give up everything, including your life. So, My Feudal Lord was an outcome of that kind of, that level of injustice. And I had to break everything, I had to break every barrier, I had to do something completely, you know, impossible even for me to do. It was impossible even for me to do, but the breakage around me all the critical breakages of relationships, especially. I think I would say it was, if I use one word, it was injustice that made me forget everything else and write it. But the consequences of this book were, not that anybody really understands them or knows them, because I haven't spoken at all about them the way they were, but for 13 years, my entire family disowned me, and my parents never saw me. It was, my father comes from Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. We come from a village in Charsata, just a few furlongs away from Fata. So you can imagine the kind of environment that my family belonged to. And this book came out of that kind of family environment. The price was very severe and heavy for me because I was alone with the mammoth enemies, because I had taken on a whole feudal system, and there was also nobody, no support. However, I must say here that the real consequence was borne by my family. My father had to carry the burden. My parents, my family had to carry the burden of my feudal lord, which I chose to write. They didn't choose to, you know, have something like this written. And so they carried it with a lot of dignity. And much as I feel that, yes, this was a price I paid, I will say here that no, it was a price they paid. They paid the price for my feudal lord. And no amount of apology for the hurt I caused them will ever be enough. And no amount of gratitude that they forgave me 10 years ago for the transgression, the forgiveness for the transgression, I think that I can never thank them enough for doing that. So really, my family suffered much, much more than I suffered.
But continuing with my feudal lord about Tehmina Durrani's disastrous marriage to Mustafa Khar, The book certainly created a literary sensation in Pakistan and around the world. In literary circles, in social circles, in political circles, it was like a bombshell. So, Tehmina, do you consider the attitudes of your ex-husband to be an inevitable product of his despotic feudal background? Or was it something peculiar to his own personality? I mean, were you taking on an individual, or were you taking on an entire decaying system?
It was not about one man. You don't write about one person. You know, writing is a much bigger thing. Even if you develop a character, even if you're writing a novel, that character represents a lot of other people. So we cannot say it's really one person and this individual was like this. It's an attitude. Feudalism is an attitude. And I understand that, of course, everybody has a different character and different personality, and some can be softer and some can, you know, but these are attitudes that are set in from the beginning when they're children, and they are victims of that background. And I do not think that there's any feudal who does not think that he's entitled. There's an entitlement that they come with, that they are men. And so this is not a one-person attitude, no. This is general. Maybe at a different level, you know? But it is a general feudal attitude.
Thank you. Tehmina, from feudal despots, you moved to depicting religious figures. Your second book, A Mirror to the Blind, is the life story of one of the most remarkable human beings of our time, Maulana Abdul Sattar Edhi, told in his own words. You'll see very little of Tehmina in the book, although she wrote the book. It is all about Abdul Sattar Edhi. And nothing could be a greater contrast than the caring gentleness associated with Saiyid Edhi and the ruthless attitudes that you have written about in My Feudal Lord. So please tell us about these contrasting attitudes, which are exhibited by separate Pakistani males that you have written about, and whether is it possible to generalize?
Well, Mr. Edhi, as we all know, is an exceptional man. So we can talk about him as one person, and there isn't another Edhi. He is the other side of the coin, but I don't think we can compare him to anybody at all. Mr. Edhi, we cannot compare, you know, to anybody at all. But my own experience with Mr. Edhi, and just, you know, moving on to A Mirror to the Blind, I spent 3 years with Edhi sir, and during which time I lived in his homes, I traveled with him, I was part of his family, and I wanted to see every aspect and of his life and find out really what inspired him, what motivated him, how did he become and achieve what he had achieved from nothing, because I believe that his example was not as difficult to follow as we may think, because he's an exceptional man. What makes it very simple and easy is that Mr. Edhi has shown all the people of this country, and the majority of them do not have affluence or influence or either the capital to begin in anything. And Mr. Edhi began with just selling pencils and matchboxes in the street, and today has a system that runs at every 25 kilometers, the length and breadth of this country, apart from that, internationally, and also is in a position today, maybe not even to want any more charity, because he's been able to sustain the institution as well as develop it into an institution that is self-sustaining now. For the majority of our people to see this example that you don't need affluence and you don't need influence and you don't need to know who's who and you don't need to have anything if your motivation and your purpose is so strong, then here is a man who's done it in front of you without anything, without any support from anybody other than his own purpose. The strength of his own purpose. So he's an example that our people do not have. We do not feel that we can achieve anything unless we are given lots of support systems. Mr. Edhi did it without that. For that reason, I think his example is very important, which is general, it's not exceptional, it's not something that we can say that only Mr. Edhi could do. In any field, it doesn't have to be humanitarianism, but in any field, success and achievement is possible if you have the commitment and the purpose of the level that Mr. Edhi has shown in his book.
Well, it's really quite remarkable that you spent 3 years of your life in the Edhi home in Karachi to write this book. Again, you know, there's a tremendous contrast between, on the one hand, the angelic Maulana Edhi, a man described as a living saint, and who's also too modest to claim such a mantle, and on the other hand, the totally evil Peer Baba of your third book, Blasphemy, who's regarded as a Muslim holy man by his unfortunate wife Heer, and by her family and the village folk all around. So please talk about this contrast and what it implies with regard to modernism, modernity and primitivism, and what are the respective sources of strength between the angelic Edhi and the retrograde Peer Baba, and which strength do you think is more durable and greater, comparing Edhi and Peer Baba? Sorry to mention their names in the same breath.
Well, Mr. I wouldn't compare them, but I can talk about, there were three or four questions in this one question, Ameena. But I will say that Edhi Saab represents the true face of Islam, and Peer Baba represents what has become of Islam. What we see Peer Baba in the story of the Peer is that Islam has become some medieval cult that we have, you know, started associating with, because we do not really understand the religion. We don't understand Arabic, so even if we read the Quran, we really don't know what it really is meaning. And so our poor people, especially, they have been for since the beginning of time, I don't know when, following this kind of Islam that can be, that is brutal, that is cruel, that you know, just uses the religion to further the interest of whatever power it is, you know, being led by. So I would, Mr. Edhi represents Islam as with an emphasis on humanitarianism being the basis of all religions. It's a completely different, you know, idea, or completely different field, attitude. It's a completely different religion, really. So we can, I don't compare the two, but we have more of the peers, and of course we have one Edhi. So we are, naturally this is still long term, it is still going to, you know, hold itself in a strong way, the peer system, the Islam that we have projected is going to have to go through its process of becoming what it really is, and it's going to go through hopefully sometime a renaissance, change, and become something else. Mr. Edhi is already showing that. He's saying this is where we have to come. This is where you will all have to finally change direction and move. And the direction he is showing is where all the characters of blasphemy will eventually have to finally move. But when that time is going to come, I mean, we can't say, it might certainly not be in our lifetime.
You've spoken briefly of your family and your support system, but certainly you took a huge risk, particularly in those days, 22 years ago and afterwards, in writing Blasphemy and My Feudal Lord. So what gave you strength, and what kind of a support system did you have to enable you to do this?
I think such bold initiatives come when you have no support system. If there is a support system, I think you're, you know, either leaning on one or thinking of the other one. Well, I had none. And because there was none, I was free to be able to become the warrior that I did become. I think also maybe that was the greatest support, but there was no support.
Yes, absolutely. I think that's what really gives one freedom and
yes,
strength. You know, you've developed an enormous following in the last 22 years since you have become a published writer. And however, as I said earlier, you have not really interacted with your readers or with your audience. So do you think that they have understood your work? And do you have any feedback about what your readers think about your work? And have they sort of understood the message that you are trying to send them through your works? Have they heard your voice?
It's taken a long time. I think that 22 years ago, there was our generation, the generation, you know, we were all conditioned. We were all, something like My Feudal Lord had not happened before. And yes, I don't think Pakistan was at least ready for something like this or somebody like me. So it did take that long. But I did get also a lot of very positive response in this whole period. I got thousands of letters, and a lot of them were from men. Even the write-ups, which at that time seemed negative to me, because they were also, you know, critical. Now when I go through them, I find that even the press, where there was at that time only the print media, we just had PTV, so there was just the print media. And I found a lot of interesting comments that even the press had made that were appreciative of the initiative. It took that long also because the new generation that has grown up in my support, I think, is coming from two places now. One is that the new generation wants to change. Women have recognized that they must become empowered. And I think the younger generation of men have also understood that that's not, you know, the way they're going to be, because the women have also changed, so they're also not wanting to take what I had to take. So there is a change in the youth, and in the people who are older, I think the consistency of my purpose, that I did not move away from it, I did not just write one book which was a story of me and leave it. I did seem to be following some path, which either was as I went to Mr. Edi or I wrote Blasphemy. They were all about the current socio-political, religious environment that we were, current environment that we were living in. So I think the consistency, the 22 years of my remaining there, had I just written My Feudal Lord, no, I would not have got the support that I have now, that I feel, that I sense, that the people have understood that this woman was trying to do something that is bigger than herself and beyond herself, or even beyond her own capabilities. So I think the consistency was a huge factor that I remained there. And then apart from the writing of the books, there were also other activities that I got involved in, like activism, whether I went on a hunger strike, you know, in 1993 for accountability, which is today a household word, and at that time there was no word accountability. It was not even on the political manifestos of any political party at that time in 1993. So I picked up issues, and then there was acid terrorism. Fakhra Yunus, you all must have heard of her, was the first and the most brutally damaged acid victim. So there was, you know, things that I picked up, and today we know what acid terrorism is and what, you know, how we have to correct this terrible situation. So it's no longer silent, you know, there's no silence on acid terrorism anymore. So those issues have also taken 22 years. You know, look at the timing of that. They've also come, didn't immediately become something. So I think I was Really what I was trying to do in my writing and my work was about creating an awareness. I was sowing some seed which would sprout later. So everything seems to be happening later, like you are saying that you have now called me today and it's for the first time. So everything did take its time, but it was my consistently being there and not changing my direction into something else that made me acceptable, maybe. I'll use the word acceptable.
Well, I think by writing about trauma, telling stories of trauma, and particularly the case that you took up of the acid case, I think that you have given a kind of a dignity to victims, and I think you've given them strength, the strength to resist and to stand up and talk about it and not just be scared and to hide it. And I think what you have written about has really gone beyond the actual story itself, but it has reached many other corners of people's minds. But Tehmina, in 12 years, you wrote 3 books. My Feudal Lord, which is actually available here, so do get your copies signed. And Idhi, A Mirror to the Blind, and I'm sorry I couldn't get hold of a copy of Blasphemy. But then after 12 years, you went silent. You've been silent for the last 10 years. So what have you been doing?
Well, I got married, so I think that contained me a little bit. And then other than that, I have written my 4th book. My 4th book is about the children of war. It's about the Soviet occupation of Afghanistan to the present war on terror. So it runs, you know, through the whole period of the war, endless war in Afghanistan. It's about 2 little children. I have illustrated the book myself in Kandahar with Mr. Idi when I went with him. The book is about global peace. It's about, unless we bring the children of war into the mainstream, we should stop talking about world peace, because there can be no peace. We're just preparing a new breed of terrorists like were left after the Soviet occupation. So this is a book that will come out on the 9th of March, inshallah, after that many years. I have also been painting. I'm an artist. And I did have one exhibition after My Feudal Lord. Now I'm having the other one next month. So I've been painting and writing and being married.
Well, that's, I suppose, painting and writing and being married is a full-time job.
Yes.
And what about your children?
Mashallah, I have 5 children, and they are all grown up and all over the world now. And 3 are married and 2 are not.
Well, that also is a full-time job, having 5 children.
It was.
Well, I think with all your experiences, and I must say you've had your range of experiences, can you tell us what, if you have a, talk to us about what you have learned, the lessons or any messages that you can share with us?
All of us have the same experiences, really, at some level or the other. From where I was coming from, my heart always has and always will belong to the oppressed people of this country or any country, anywhere in the world. So I think that wherever I see oppression or cruelty or injustice, I have a complete affiliation with that person. And I have gathered from wherever, anywhere in the world, not just Pakistan, but anywhere in the world, I have gathered that we have not recognized how empowered we are as human beings. The citizen, citizens of the ordinary citizen of all countries has huge empowerment if they decide to do something in a unified way. For instance, you have seen that how it was the people of Pakistan that restored the Chief Justice. We've all seen how that movement took place and how something that huge happened. So we are in a position to make governments follow our decisions and give us our rights. We can get them. I remember at the time of Fakhra Yunus, the government was not giving me her travel documents. She had no identity papers. And it was again the print media, the people of Pakistan, who wrote the telegrams to the then president. And what the importance that the media gave, the print media gave, especially the Urdu press, to the case that her identity papers were essential as a right. They had to give the papers. They were not ready to give those papers, just like they were not ready to restore the Chief Justice. So if we can recognize how empowered we are, then the government is our servant. And we have to make them behave. That we have to make them behave because we have placed them there. And they have to recognize that unless they are going to serve us, they are no use for us. We can do that, and we have done that, but we seem to forget it along the line. In the same way, as now I'm talking about all citizens and the unity of citizens, but every person, every single person, if you can empower yourself and recognize what you are capable of and what you can do, and if you do take a step forward, you're not going to take it back. If you have faith in your own purpose and your own belief in what you are doing, and if it is important enough to you, whatever it is, I think that my message to all people is that look at me. I'm your best example. I had nothing. I mean, if somebody could start with this and become acceptable, bring up her children, get married to a very fine man with five children, having five children and two failed marriages and the baggage of my feudal lord, and yet, you know, I think it's a success story. I'm a success story. Yes. So if you look at me as a success story, you will understand that what was the power that gave her this? The power was only, you know, within myself. Nobody gave it to me from outside. I did not have it I did not inherit it. Nobody made it easy for me. I made it for myself. So it's your own power. That's my message.
I think the stories that you have written about in your books, these are well known. I mean, we do know about the violence of men and the feudal mindset and these fake peers. And they've been written about, but they have been written about objectively. You have written about them subjectively, and that is, I think, what has resonated with your readers. Yes. That is what made them a part of the story and made the book so relevant for them. But I think I agree with you absolutely. It's remarkable for a woman with five children, a woman who had been battered and divorced, to have achieved a happy marriage. But I think it also speaks volumes for Mr. Shahbaz Sharif, Tehmina's husband. So please tell us about Shahbaz Sharif.
Yes, people keep thinking I'm going to write another book one day and it's going to be about him. But you can't keep writing books like this. It's only a once in a lifetime thing. What can I tell you about him? I mean, he's a gift from God.
Have you ridden in the new bus service in Lahore?
Before it was launched many times, yes. I saw the development of the work. But I must say that here, that as you have pointed out, that it says a lot about Mr. Shahbaz Sharif, that he married me. Is that what you mean?
Well, they made you happy.
Made me happy. Well, I think that the fact that he was able to bring himself to marry somebody like me, you know, usually in the Muslim world especially, you can be 90 years old and you want to marry a 19-year-old girl. Huh? And if you're 20, you want to marry a 19, and if you're 90, you want to marry a 19, but if you're above that, it's over. So it's in the, this is something especially in Saudi Arabia and places like that, it's very commonly known. The fact that he married a woman with five children and two marriages, failed marriages, and was ready to marry the writer of My Feudal Lord with the character in that book roaming around in the same province as him, and as well known or very well known in the same field, says a lot about how progressive and how liberal he is. Although, you know, we don't think that of the party, but yes, as a man, he has shown it and proved it by being married to me. Also, I hope that one day everybody will recognize that any woman whose standard of commitment was as mine became and as Mr. Edie's influence on me, that I don't think I could marry a man and live with him if I doubted his level of commitment to the people and to the poor and to this country. I do not think I could, you know, live my life there. Not possible. My standard was too high, and I think I married the right man for the people of my country. I think he is a man who is committed beyond himself.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, you know, we had invited Mr. Shahbaz Sharif also to the Karachi Literature Festival for a different reason, to launch a children's history of the Punjab by Hamida Khoro. But I think he's so busy running the province that he couldn't take the time out.
Yeah.
Although we are going ahead with the launch, I think Kamla Shamsi is now launching it. But hopefully he will also join us at some other.
Inshallah.
I wish you a wonderful married life and a wonderful life, having gone through so much. And I have so many more questions, but I'd like to open the floor to questions from Gio. Let's do it afterwards. Oh, okay.
Yet to you, the benchmark here seems to be marriage, so I said full back.
No, not at all. That's part of it. The fact that I'm sitting here is my achievement.
You just spoke about...
No, the fact that I'm sitting here is my achievement. The fact that I have been able to survive without a marriage is my achievement. But the fact that eventually that also happened for most women, and we can, you know, say that it's not important, but most women are looking to get married. And most women in this country, especially, so I'm talking to them, that as an example, whatever you do, if it is true, if it is consistent, if it has purpose, if you have a goal, if you are, you know, if you are not directionless, and if you are strong, you can get it all right. So it, he's part of it. Marriage is part of it. It is a very important part of it. I think another achievement I would like to tell you is that it did not color my vision of marriage. My vision of men did not get completely, you know, broken down and torn down, that all men are now going to be, or all marriage is never again. So it is, has happened, and it is, that itself is an achievement.
Any other questions? Ji, Shahzeb.
Shazaf.
Assalamualaikum. Assalamualaikum.
I just want to tell you that when my mom gave me my first pocket money, it was not a lot, I bought your book. And then I gave it to my cousin and she wasn't allowed to read it, so she used to hide in the bathroom and read it. So there, this is the kind of controversy, you know, that... So I wanted to establish the fact that I am a huge admirer of yours, but I'm going to ask you another question, which a lot of people ask me, and I defend you, but I'd like to hear you defend yourself. Yeah. Which is, in a way, yes, you really did fight for the cause of women, you know, I mean, you were the original abused wife for us, you know, who spoke out. But also you know, a lot of people say that you didn't help women a lot because of the story that you told and the person and the details that were in that story. And I see you branded, I've seen you branded, I mean, in many, many ways, but one of those brands also the opportunist. So what would you like to say about that?
I have heard that many times, but what was the opportunity? And opportunism comes when you are getting something but you're not paying anything really for it. That's an opportunity, you know? An opportunity doesn't make you lose everything. What kind of opportunism is that? That you risk your life for opportunism? So it was a difficult thing for people to understand, and because it was very quickly branded that this is wrong, it was not the norm. I mean, certainly if it was the norm, we'd have a book coming out of most houses. It was something that people would hide and read, and of course I know many people like this. Why it was considered opportunism, why was it taken like that, was, I think, just a very superficial shunning away of something that you don't like and you don't want to know. And you'd rather, it was like also like a mirror, you know, so you see so many things that you'd rather not ever discover about yourself either. So yes, it was that, but no, opportunism, I mean, I'm sure if now you ask them, they will say, it's not that. Anything else?
Any other questions?
Assalamu Tina, we Hello. Were in school together, Fazal and Rahman. I remember you as extremely funny and loving, and I remember you saying that the most important thing in the world is love. So you clearly have found it. Congratulations.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you.
Ms. Durrani, I remember I read your book when I was 15, and I did not know then.
Please,
that
could you stand up? I can't see you.
I did not know then that I'd be going through the same circumstances that you did at that time. So what would you suggest to such women who are not that strong and they cannot expose such element, you know, that are there in life? I don't feel I'm strong enough. So what would you suggest to such women?
I think one, no, don't say that you're not that strong. Because I don't think there was anyone weaker than me. You don't know you're that strong. I didn't know. I felt I was not strong. But I was. So don't come to that conclusion, firstly. And if there is anything that is, because you're not born to be unhappy. I think that the greatest expression of gratitude to God, the greatest expression, the only maybe expression of gratitude to God, is to be happy. So if you want to show that gratitude, then you've got to cut your losses, face them, but you cannot afford to be unhappy. That's ingratitude. Because how can you be alive and be unhappy? There's too much to be happy about. Just having your hands is happiness. Just having your eyes is happiness. That's gratitude. So cut your losses. Axe them. And you can. I can see it in your eyes.
Please go ahead.
Yeah, I'm a prophet, I'm a sociologist, and I like to ask you a question, which is not personal. After writing the book, I feel lost.
I can't hear.
Could you hold the mic closer?
Yeah, after writing the book, my feudal law, do you think any changes have occurred in the law and the people you are?
Changes have occurred in? Sorry, I didn't get the end.
In the Lord himself and the other feudal lords.
Ah. Well, my feudal lord, the name of the book, did coin an expression. You now recognize feudal lord. You know, there was no feudal lord before my feudal lord, the book came out. That expression. Has it changed though? You're saying, has it changed? I don't think people change. I don't think people change.
Really? Well, there are cases sometimes people reinvent themselves, I don't know.
Yeah, but they don't change. They can, you know, you can acquire certain things or put away certain things, but that type of change, no. And as far as feudalism is concerned, as a country we are suffering from it. The influence, the feudal influence, has affected us so deeply that we have not settled as a nation because of the feudal influence in politics. We, our people have not been able to find their strength because of the control, because of that captive support that they have in their areas. So no, that hasn't changed, no. But we are recognizing it. We are aware of it more. We are talking about it more. We have a better understanding of it. Yes, we are changing. People are changing. But they don't. They have no reason to change. Who wants to change when they are king? I mean, you don't want to give up the kingdom. So, for them to change is difficult. For us to change is much easier.
Tehmina, can I ask about your special relationship with Italy? Because I know you've had several Italian awards. Your books have been translated into Italian. And yesterday we launched the book by an Italian writer, Lorenza Rapponi, on Idhi. And I think in the case of the asset case also, I think you arranged to send her to Italy. Is that a coincidence, or do you find that you're getting a lot of support from there?
I have not understood it myself really, but Italy just became a second home. The people in Italy, as much as the people in Pakistan know my feudal lord, I would find people in, you know, like a chef for a maid or a nanny, and a nanny's daughter would want to come and meet me because she had read it. So it became a huge bestseller in Italy. And after that, I made a lot of friends and I got a lot of support. So I think whether it was Fakhra, whether it was Idi Saab's book, A Mirror to the Blind, was translated also in Italian by Mondadori. And in particular, because of that book, he was then given the Balzan Peace Prize for 2 million Swiss francs. In Italy. So whether it was Fakhra or Idi Saab or any other work that I did, all the awards mostly that I got were from there. There was some affiliation. Perhaps it was also that the women in Italy have some of the same types of problems that we have. It was that too. I think it was a lot to do with that.
Thank you. I think that brings us to the end of the session. Okay, one last question. Last, please.
Okay, assalamu alaikum. Being a teacher, I come across every day some of the issues the fathers are dominating, and I think feudal fathers are there everywhere in the home. Can you advise some of the things that we can help out so our siblings or our children do not become the feudal lawyers when they grow up? How can I get into things in their mind that is not allowed? And yes, and these kind of talks, yes, we get the chance to attend these kind of literacy programs. What about the public out there?
I can't understand.
Actually, you can't hear you properly.
Yeah.
Okay, the first question just was, being a teacher, you know, I come across with a lot of issues in school where my children are facing this kind of feudal systems at their home. And I'm sure that we have to tell them or teach them a way that it is not allowed. I think feudal systems are in our homes everywhere in some extent. Can you advise us what to do that our children, when grow up, they are away from these kind of issues in their home?
I think you're asking me what you should tell the children that you teach.
Some kind of advices, you know.
Advice
for teachers, yes.
Of how to deal with
yes.
an attitude at home. I don't think that we can tell children what to do, because they really are helpless. They are dependent on that, you know, that if the attitude is coming from their parents, which is in most homes, I think we cannot really make them different, because they're not going to be able to put up that fight. They're not going to be able to fight or be disobedient or, you know, not follow the rules and the regulations and the norms that are set in their home by their parents. So it's more important to change the attitude of the parents. What can poor children do? I mean, realistically speaking, I think that's not something that we are capable of extending to. Sorry, I don't have an answer to that.
Okay, just, okay. Mic, please, quickly, in the front.
I'd like to ask you one thing. After experiencing so much, you've gone through a lot and struggled throughout. I think you need to give a message to the men who have these children, especially to the men who have these children and they abandon them with the wives. And the wives are supposed to struggle with them and bring them up, and they don't look back. And they have to, don't you think you need to give a message to them?
I have many messages to give to many, you know, different types of people, but yes, this is a very important question, because in my own experience and in the experiences of many, many Muslim women who I have spoken to, when there is a divorce, men leave the children to the wife and they do not pay for their children anymore. That huge responsibility on a woman who is usually not equipped to earn for herself. She's neither been educated by her parents so that she can become economically independent, neither does the husband allow her to become economically independent and make her settle down. So by the time there's a divorce, she's usually on the street. And if she's now got children, you have exposed a woman of the Muslim religion, which you keep saying should be covered and should be wearing a hijab and should, you know, behave in certain ways, and there are a million rules and regulations for women. But you then expose her to having nothing else but her body to sell. I mean, let's just be plain and simple. That's all she has, really. So what is the use of that garment which you are saying cover yourself with? Because that's not going to help you. You've got to feed many children. And you are not equipped. And outside there are vultures and wolves. And any workplace that even if you become a telephone operator in, or you become a sweeper in, forget about anything else you want to do, there are compromises. And you begin to compromise because you have to feed your children. There is no hijab. Hijab is, for me, and I am talking a lot about this now, alimony. All civilized countries, all civilized governments, alimony is not in the Bible, it is not in the Torah, it is not in the Quran, but civilized governments have recognized that the empowerment of the woman, the safety of the woman, the hijab of the woman is that she must have alimony so that she can be empowered. At that time, she should not be compromised. Governments have done that. The feminist movement did that. In the Muslim world, it has not happened. So this is a compromise. This is a situation that Muslim women get into. There is no child support. I remember trying to get child support for my children, and I was told by Asma Jahangir that don't even bother. You will get 2,000 rupees a month. That's the maximum that even from a very wealthy man. So there is. And you can keep going on about it. It's not going to happen. So neither the legal system was strong enough for us, neither did they provide for us in any way. But the only thing that they keep telling us to do is cover ourselves. Now, that is no cover. And I think this will have to change in the Muslim world. I certainly am now prepared and ready to stand up and fight for women to get alimony.
Thank you very much, Tehmina Durrani, for talking to us. And I'm afraid we've come to the end of the session. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And please buy Tehmina's books. It's a rare chance to get them signed.
Thank you. Thank you very much for coming. Thank you.